Today, it is our pleasure to welcome Robert S. Sikes, who will speak to us about oversight of research involving animal wildlife. Dr. Sikes earned a B.S. from the University of Arkansas at Little Rock, an M.S. from Memphis State University, and a Ph.D. from the University of Minnesota. His academic training and research interests center on the behavioral and evolutionary ecology of mammals. With regard to oversight of animal use, Dr. Sikes served as both an IACUC member and as the chair prior to assuming his current roles as professor of biology and director of Basic Animal Services Unit of the University of Arkansas at Little Rock. Dr. Sikes has been a member of the Animal Care and Use Committee of the American Society of Mammalogists since 1997 and has chaired that committee since 2008. He's been a panelist at various symposia on the use of wildlife in research and was the co-convener of the 2011 conference on IACUC oversight of wildlife research in Albuquerque, New Mexico. He regularly presents at national meetings on topics related to oversight of wildlife animal research. Dr. Sikes is the senior author of the 2011 Guides of the American Society of Mammalogists for the Use of Wild Mammals in Research. It is my pleasure to welcome Dr. Sikes to OLAW online webinar series. Bob?
Thank you, George, and hello, everyone. Thank you for participating in this webinar about the oversight of research involving wildlife. The recommendations and resources that I am sharing with you today are the result of a truly enormous effort by many individuals. I just happen to be the spokesperson for today's session. Ellen Paul of the Ornithological Council has been deeply involved in the development of these materials, as have Drs. John Bryan with the National Park Service and Stephen Beaupre, past president of the American Society of Ichthyologists and Herpetologists. This talk is organized to touch on some of the questions and issues that IACUCs wrestle with most frequently. I will point out that many of these issues have been addressed in great detail in some of the recent publications by my colleagues and I. OLAW has provided a link for the resources referenced in this webinar and the slideshow or the PowerPoint package that supports it at the URL shown here. One of the resources included at this link is a sample protocol that was designed specifically for wildlife activities. This sample protocol document was developed as one of the products from that conference held in Albuquerque in October of 2011 that did focus on the oversight of wildlife research. In addition to being reviewed by NIH OLAW, the sample protocol has been reviewed by ALAC International, which has also agreed to post it as resource material for interested parties. This sample protocol is also available on the websites of the American Society of Mammalogists and the Ornithological Council. Please note that the PowerPoint file that accompanies this webinar has clickable links to the resources referenced herein, and these sites will provide some additional useful materials for you. The sample protocol is provided as a beta version in Word format to make it easy for institutions to adapt it to their specific situations. The protocol covers topics that are important to the oversight of wildlife research, and it actually provides quite a bit of additional detail and guidance to PIs and IACUCs regarding wildlife research in the introductory material. And for those of you seeking even more information, there will be a panel discussion and workshop on wildlife research at the upcoming Primer IACUC conference in Denver on April 1st and 2nd of 2014, and also at the annual SCAW meeting, Scientist Center for Animal Welfare, in San Antonio in December of 2014. And finally, there's a brand new wildlife course that's available through the CITI program that's written by the same collaborators I've already mentioned. After that recap of contributors and resources, let's jump into this topic, the oversight of research involving wildlife. Wildlife research is challenging, and the review of any project involving wild animals is also challenging. And I have to tell you, this is equally true for IACUCs that handle wildlife research on a regular basis or even exclusively. The difficulties come from many places, most of which are beyond the control of the IACUC, but the challenges grow when relevant resources are not used or when wildlife activities are evaluated using tools that are not designed for those species and types of work. The goal of this webinar is to highlight approaches and resources that will assist institutions in conducting sound reviews of projects involving wild animals. Many of the ideas that I will present are covered as suggestions for IACUCs that accompany the sample IACUC protocol that I discussed earlier. So what makes oversight of wildlife activities so tough? Well, to begin with, whereas most biomedical research involves fewer than 10 or 15 species or so, there is something more than 52,000 species of vertebrates that are potential subjects for your investigators. These animals occur in virtually every possible environment, and you usually cannot order them from a Class A dealer like you would a laboratory animal. Further, trade in many of these species of wildlife is actually illegal and can land you in jail. The screen before you now, if you will back up to that wildlife slide just for a second. On this screen, you see some of the diversity of activities that investigators might engage in. The neon mouse on the lower left, or on the left side of the screen, is one where students actually powdered this with a fluorescent powder and then came back and tracked it at night with black lights. It may involve capturing birds for an ornithology class, again below the neon mouse, or trapping beaver in the lower left corner of the screen. Or perhaps students are capturing water snakes around minnow ponds, as shown on the right screen. In other words, there's just a tremendous diversity in the types of animals and the types of questions that one might ask. Well, given this diversity of species, situations, and questions, it's not possible to assemble a committee with expertise in more than a tiny subset. But having at least one member with real expertise in fieldwork with vertebrates is hugely beneficial. These individuals bring not only taxonomic expertise, but they bring a familiarity with the ins and outs of field research and an understanding of the different types of questions posed as compared to biomedical work. They also will be familiar with the permitting process that is required for virtually every wildlife project. But even if you have a member with wildlife expertise, you still need to ensure that these individuals weigh in during protocol review. If your institution uses a designated member review system, it's especially important to ensure that these members with wildlife expertise are included in the review of these types of protocols. Now, if deliberations require additional expertise, the committee should keep in mind that the PI may well be an expert on the species in question. Additionally, the committee can always reach out to the professional community. As chair of the Mammal Society's Animal Care and Use Committee, I regularly field questions from IACUC members and PIs wondering about specific techniques or appropriate capture methods for species X. And I know that my counterparts with the other taxon-based societies do as well. If the question is one that we can't answer ourselves, we have the rest of our professional organizations to consult. We will do our best to find an answer or at least identify a resource for you, and we welcome your questions. Please note that the PHS policy supports consultation to assist in review of complex issues, and that such consultation is encouraged by OLAW. So with that, contact information for myself and Ellen Paul are listed here. For representatives for the other taxon societies, listeners are reviewed to their own websites. Even when you have the wildlife expertise on your committee, it is still important to use appropriate tools to evaluate proposed activities and to remain in compliance with all applicable regulations. Whether dealing with laboratory species, wildlife, or agricultural animals, it's imperative that the IACUC be mindful of the wording of the institution's animal welfare assurance. The scope of applicability of this assurance is critical in determining which guidelines IACUCs may use as primary resources for evaluating proposed activities. As I am sure you are all aware, PHS policy requires that all PHS-funded activities be conducted in a manner that is consistent with the Guide for the Care and Use of Laboratory Animals. An institution may choose to extend the scope of that assurance to include all vertebrate animals, regardless of funding, or they may leave it to those activities that are funded by the PHS. The scope of an institution's animal welfare assurance should be tailored to the needs of the institution, and it should ensure that the animals are handled ethically, humanely, and responsibly as appropriate to the species. Where the PHS policy applies, the guide is the primary standard. Other resources can be used to supplement or complement that standard. In fact, OLAW encourages IACUCs to consult other resources, including the taxon-specific guidelines, and provides links to those resources on the OLAW website shown on this slide. If you will click on that link, there are a variety of wildlife-related materials located under the species-specific section. So, in instances where the applicability of the institution's animal welfare assurance does not extend to non-PHS-funded activities, then other documents, such as taxon-specific guidelines or the Ag Guide, may serve as primary references for the details involving the species under consideration. Regardless of the wording of the assurance, the important point here, the take-home, is that IACUCs should be using the most appropriate resources to the task at hand, and they need to understand that they have the latitude to use those resources. The Guide for the Care and Use of Laboratory Animals was developed for biomedical applications. And since most biomedical research, especially at academic institutions, is funded by PHS sources, recognition of the guide as the primary standard in the PHS policy is understandable. And since most IACUCs deal far more with protocols involving laboratory animals than wildlife, their familiarity and reliance on the guide is also understandable. But this document is actually a very poor fit for wildlife activities. Most of the specifics that are especially important in dealing with wild taxa are not covered in that document, whereas these items are the reason that taxon-specific guidelines came into being. A brief review of their origin is appropriate, and for those of you who would like additional information on the development of these taxon-specific guidelines, I'll refer you to the 2011 Bioscience article that's included in the reference materials that support this webinar. That document provides a detailed timeline of this development process. So briefly, oversight of wildlife research came under the IACUC's purview in 1986 when PHS policy was issued in response to congressional directive regarding the Health Research Extension Act. The policy required compliance with the guide as a requirement for PHS funding. The National Science Foundation, which has always funded a large percentage of wildlife research, voluntarily adopted the PHS policy when it was issued. At that same time, however, the National Science Foundation realized that the application of the guide to wildlife would be problematic, and they approached the professional taxon societies of the United States and recommended that these organizations develop guidelines specific to the taxa for which they were the recognized experts. As a result of this, in 1987 and 1988, we see the publication or revision of guidelines for mammals, for birds, for fishes, and for reptiles and amphibians. At about the same time, the agricultural community developed guidelines that were specific to the farm species. Recent years have seen a growing concern about the overdependence of IACUCs on the guide for evaluating wildlife activities, so much so that in 2013, the National Science Foundation explicitly recognized the suitability of taxon-specific guidelines for work funded by them and involving wildlife. These taxon-specific guidelines are consistent with the laws and regulations governing the use of animals in research and education, but they're tailored specifically for wild animals, particularly wild animals in their natural environments. As a consequence, they focus on the issues that IACUCs and PIs really should be taking into consideration for oversight of work involving these animals. For example, the taxon guidelines cover capture techniques in great detail because this is how one obtains wild animals. In contrast, capture or trapping techniques are not relevant to work with domesticated animals in laboratory settings, and consequently, they're not covered in the guide. The taxon guidelines also cover the permitting process, and that labyrinth is our next topic. In terms of animal work, permits are pretty much unique to the wildlife arena, and there they are ubiquitous. Virtually every type of work is going to require one or more permits, and all of these permits are usually to be obtained from different agencies. Local requirements typically include a state collecting permit and permits for working in or on state or local parks or reserves, if those are intended study sites. Federal permits, on the other hand, are required for migratory birds or marine mammals, and import permits if the work involves bringing animals or animal parts into the United States. work in foreign countries usually will require additional permits from the country hosting the research. Importantly, for oversight considerations, all of these permits are issued to the individual PI conducting the work and not to the institution. Further, even if the IACUC has approved the activities described in the protocol, the work cannot be conducted lawfully without the required permits. Because the permitting deadlines, renewals, and reports all fall on very different schedules than the IACUC review process, this presents a conundrum for the IACUCs. Because IACUCs cannot provide conditional approval, there are two options open to them. They can either require permits, copies of all permits prior to protocol review to verify that the proposed work can be conducted lawfully, or they can review and approve the work but specify to the PI, preferably in writing, that any work requiring permits may not be conducted until all required permits are in place and current. Each of these possible approaches has advantages and disadvantages, and the best choices will likely depend on the institution. If permits are required before protocol review, the preparation process really should start far in advance of the planned work, perhaps even a year or more. And if the different reporting and renewal deadlines will require quite a bit of considerable bookkeeping. In contrast, if the institution places the burden for permit compliance on the PI, it removes a level of certainty for the institution that all work is conducted in strict compliance with the permit requirements. Regardless of which path that the institution chooses to handle this permitting process, it is recommended that the IACUC not use ambiguous language when communicating with the PI on this matter. You should also note that any work requiring a permit that is conducted without all permits in place is in fact non-compliance. And because it's non-compliance, it's reportable to the appropriate bodies. Listeners should be aware that the sample protocol contains the following statement in bold font. It's on your screen, but it's important enough that I'm going to read it again. If your research requires federal or state permits, it is unlawful to begin work until all permits have been obtained. You may not start the work for which the permits are required until the permits are issued, even if your protocol has been approved. We strongly recommend that such a statement also be included in correspondence with the PI. Beyond the legal requirements of obtaining permits prior to the planned work, there actually are benefits of the permitting process for appropriate oversight of wildlife research. Additional benefits. The wild animals that are the focus of wildlife research exist in nature as part of a local population and a community. These are terms that have little relevance to animals used in biomedical work. Whereas concern for the individual animal is important in both arenas, the potential impact on populations is far more important in wildlife research. IACUCs usually are in a poor position to evaluate the potential impact of proposed activities on populations, but this is a concern and a focus of most permitting agencies, which are usually responsible for maintaining an area's biota. As a consequence, IACUCs can view the permit approval as an additional evaluation that impacts on local populations are either minimal or they're justified. It's important to note, with regard to permits, however, that the permitting agency probably has not evaluated the proposed activities with regard to ethical standards or humane techniques. In almost all instances, the permit application forms simply do not include the same fields that IACUCs will use to evaluate, that IACUCs will evaluate in their deliberations, and the permitting committees are not reviewed, review process does not include a body with the same composition of an IACUC. The only exception that I know of with regard to this last point is the National Park Service. Their IACUC will review any project to be conducted on National Park Service lands using a form very similar to the sample protocol that we are providing. In fact, our protocol document was modified from that NPS form. So now that we have the permits in place and we understand what guidelines we can use, can we get to the field? Well, what field? And what constitutes a field study? Let's explore that just a bit. What constitutes a field study? And are all projects involving wild animals subject to IACUC review? This is a topic that, again, depends on the language of an institution's assurance. OLAW's Frequently Asked Question A6 states that if the activities are PHS supported and involve vertebrate animals, then the IACUC is responsible for oversight in accord with PHS policy. IACUCs must know where field studies will be located, they must know what procedures will be involved, and they must be sufficiently familiar with the nature of the habitat to assess the potential impact on animal subjects. If the activity alters or influences the activities of the animals that are being studied, the activity must be reviewed and approved by the IACUC, for example, capture and release, banding. If the activity does not alter or influence the activity of the animals, then IACUC review and approval is not required, for example, observational work, photography, and collection of feces. But even for those activities that are not covered by the institution's assurance, the Animal Welfare Act may well apply. The Animal Welfare Act applies to all warm-blooded vertebrates except birds, rats of the genus Rattus, and mice of the genus Mus, bred for research. If covered species are used, they must be included on annual USDA reports. However, the Animal Welfare Act also has an exclusion for field studies conducted in the animal's natural environment that do not involve invasive procedures, harm, or materially alter the behavior of an animal under study. Although the terms harm and materially alter behavior are not further defined, it is important that the IACUC have a process in place to identify studies that qualify as field studies under this regulatory language. This is a determination that should come from the IACUC and from IACUC deliberations based on the regulatory definition rather than from a checkbox completed by the PI saying that work will be conducted in the field. Okay, now we've got our guidance. We know what permits are required. Can we finally get down to working with animals? Well, still, not yet. Obtaining wild animals almost always involves capturing them yourself or acquiring them from a colleague. If the latter, then there are probably even more state permits involved for interstate transfer of wild animals and material transfer agreements. If the former, then suitable capture techniques must be identified. So how do we go about getting these animals? Given the diversity of species, it really should come as no surprise to anyone that there is also a great diversity of capture techniques and traps, and that these methods are constantly evolving as more effective methods are devised. Regardless of the trap used, the objective is always the most humane capture possible if the animal is to be taken alive, and a humane death if it is to be killed. Some of the animals can be captured by hand or net. Whether easily or not, that's another question. Others must be taken with kill traps or by gunshot. Coverage of even a fraction of the traps and capture techniques is beyond the scope of this talk, but these topics are covered in detail by the taxon-specific guidelines. The IACUC should ensure that capture techniques planned are appropriate to the species and the study objectives. Both the PI and the IACUC should also consider the incidental capture of non-target species. Traps and nets are usually not species-specific, but they often can be set in such a way as to minimize the capture of non-target animals. Along with capture, IACUCs and PIs must consider the use of chemical immobilization for wild animals. Beyond relieving pain or distress, anesthetics and tranquilizers are used frequently in wildlife to facilitate handling and to allow collecting needed samples. Depending on the species and requirements, these chemical agents might be an absolute necessity for the safe handling of the animals. Because of their fear of humans, many wild animals will thrash about and become dangerous to themselves and to personnel. In these instances, there really is no question that the presence of humans causes stress, but seldom does it go so far as to cause distress. For example, many animals are aged by examining teeth, or tissue samples may be required. While these types of data do not necessarily require and usually don't require painful or invasive techniques, if you're taking them from an unsedated raccoon or an unsedated bobcat or mountain lion, well, that might be a little bit more of an adventure than most researchers wish to experience. Chemical immobilization in such cases protects both the animals and the humans. When categorizing these activities for USDA reporting, the IACUC should remain cognizant of why these chemical agents are being used and whether the animal is experiencing pain or distress, or whether the compounds are used for safe handling and the animal is experiencing only stress. If chemical agents are to be used on animals that are then released, what are the chances of those compounds then entering the food chain if the treated animal is later killed or dies? What are the likely effects on predators or scavengers? Secondary poisoning is a very real possibility in these cases and must be considered. Additionally, many of our animal subjects are in studies because they are game animals. In other words, animals that are potentially for human consumption. With that in mind, all parties must be particularly aware of the species and the timing relative to local hunting or fishing seasons when chemical agents are used. Some study designs require that wild animals be brought into captivity. When this is the case, the IACUC and the animal husbandry personnel must realize that just because the animals are in cages, like domesticated animals, they certainly cannot be handled as such. Close proximity to humans and unfamiliar surroundings are stressors. These animals are not used to processed diets, and they're not used to confinement. For many species, the PI and the animal care staff will have to develop novel housing arrangements. Both the IACUC and the PI need to be open to trying different systems, keeping in mind that the normal behaviors and habitats are what you want to try to approximate, and try to make captive conditions match those wild conditions to the extent possible. This might involve environments with a lot of vertical structure if you're keeping flying squirrels, or it may involve caging with suitable refuges in the case of really a great number of wild species. A great example is the intricate system of interconnected chambers that investigators have designed for keeping the eusocial and subterranean naked mole rat in captivity. But what if the research design calls for keeping a solitary subterranean animal, like some species of pocket gopher? The animal on the left of the screen is a pocket gopher, and the housing system is depicted directly below. This is a housing system that actually was developed by a graduate student working in the lab, where she wanted to look at behavior of these animals. Notice that it's three interconnected rat cages, and they're connected with PVC tubing. Also notice that each of these has a different bedding substrate. The animal is simply placed in. They can move from cage to cage, from container to container, and they can rearrange the bedding, the substrates, to suit themselves. To take it even further, the student developed a cover that would fit over one of these, and the animal had the choice then of building its nest under the covered container, one of the open containers, and moving any substrate anywhere it wanted. They were in control of their own environment. Interestingly, in this system, the cage tops, the wire cage tops, were turned upside down and fastened to the cages, and the food, fresh produce typically, was placed inside the cage on the substrate. This allowed the animals to cache their food exactly the way they would in nature. Another interesting detail with this system is that the animals existed for 2 years in the lab and never had access to a water bottle. This is a species that exists in nature and survives on metabolic water, not on free water. Thoughts on captive housing might also take some serious consideration of the diets animals are provided, such as produce or live prey. I have colleagues that have experienced these issues firsthand when they were trying to rear hatchling water snakes on killed rather than live fish. The snakes were not doing well, and many were refusing to eat. Their growth rates were depressed to the point that they were becoming emaciated, and growth curves were well below those of free-ranging snakes. When the diet was switched to live prey, growth rates returned to what the investigators were seeing in free-ranging animals, and the young snakes were thriving. In this situation, by offering the snakes only killed fish, the researchers were inadvertently inducing distress, whereas when live prey were fed, the apparent distress of the subject animals was eliminated. Okay, once the project is over, what should we do with these wild animals that we have in captivity? In most instances, releasing captive animals back to the wild is not advisable, and in fact, it might not be legal. Remember that the local population must be protected, And releasing captive animals can have seriously negative consequences. The captive animals may have no familiarity with the local environment, and they're not acclimated to natural conditions. For territorial species, introduction of new individuals will generate conflict and may squeeze resident animals, that is, if the introduced animals survive. In many instances, the release of captive animals into the environment is forbidden, specifically to protect the native populations. These are just some of the factors that should be considered prior to release of captive animals. And I would suggest that you look at some of the taxon-specific guidelines that are going to cover these and some additional topics in greater detail regarding release. Ending the lives of animals is another area where the language of an institution's assurance is of great importance. Because OLAW recognizes the AVMA guidelines for the euthanasia of animals as a sole reference standard for euthanasia, methods of euthanasia must comply with the AVMA guidelines for all activities funded by PHS, unless the IACUC has approved a deviation. Deviations must be scientifically justified. If the institution's animal welfare assurance applies to all work with vertebrate animals, regardless of funding source, then all activities must be in compliance with the requirements for research funded by the PHS. As I've mentioned earlier in this talk, other funding agencies, including the National Science Foundation, have voluntarily elected to follow PHS policy, but the NSF also expressly recognizes these guidelines published by the professional taxon societies as appropriate references. If the circumstances of field settings or study requirements preclude the use of methods that are deemed acceptable by the AVMA for euthanasia, the investigators may request approval of alternative methods to humanely end the lives of wild animals. Such a request is consistent with AVMA guidelines, which recognize that ending the life of wild animals in field settings might more appropriately be considered humane killing than euthanasia. Although the AVMA guidelines expressly do not apply to humane killing, methods considered acceptable therein are also acceptable and preferred for humane killing where possible. Under PHS policy, section 4C1G, the IACUC has the authority to approve killing techniques not recognized as forms of euthanasia by the AVMA with scientific justification. Examples of other methods used for euthanasia or humane killing include those approved by the professional taxon societies. Whether you consider euthanasia or humane killing, it is expected that investigators will use the most humane technique feasible that is also consistent with study objectives. And as with compounds used for chemical immobilization, care must be taken to ensure that those agents used for euthanasia or humane killing do not enter the food chain. Carcasses of animals killed by drug overdose can cause secondary toxicosis in any animal consuming them. Let's move to occupational health and safety. There are risks inherent in field work that simply do not exist in laboratories. Many of these risks are the same ones that an individual would encounter hiking or conducting any other outdoor recreational activity. The risks may range from poison ivy and allergic reactions to bee stings, to attacks from cornered study animals and zoonoses where animal contact is involved. Risk assessment should include the likelihood of encountering the various hazards and the seriousness of each hazard. Protective measures should match the real risk. Importantly, risk assessment and education efforts should include unnamed participants when they occur. For example, students taking field courses. In fact, if you look at the slides accompanying this webinar, most of the photographs involve students in teaching situations. Suitable precautions usually can be established without inhibiting an institution's ability to offer these field courses or to adversely impact research efforts. But it might take some additional consultation or some review by the IACUC or the occupational health staff. Although any wild animal will be exposed to parasites and pathogens as part of their normal life, and they might harbor these organisms, most of these are host-specific and pose little threat to humans. Where there are exceptions, however, their effects can be very serious. It is inappropriate to consider every animal in the wild to be rabid, just as it is inappropriate to consider no wild animal to pose a threat. The truth is somewhere between. This is where input is needed from sources familiar with the threats. Individual investigators are often experts on the species they study, and they're usually well-versed on potential pathogens associated with those species. As such, they are valuable resources for the IACUC. Other resources, again, include the taxon-specific guidelines, the U.S. Centers for Disease Control, and state health departments. Protective measures, whatever is decided on, should be based on the potential hazards present and the likelihood of encountering those hazards given the nature of the project. Preventive measures can range from simple awareness of the potential risks to immunizations or to full protective clothing. Perhaps the single most important thing to remember with regard to potential biological hazards is that personnel should be advised to inform their healthcare provider of their contact with wild animals and field conditions should they become ill. Okay, with that, I want to draw this portion of the webinar to a close, and I want to thank you all for participating, and I want to thank OLAW for the invitation to talk on this topic. I'm going to leave you with this one last slide of additional resources for wildlife work. I will also remind you of the upcoming panel discussions and workshops at the PRIMER meeting in Denver in April of 2014. This is the first week in April, and also at the SCAW meetings in San Antonio in December of 2014. These presentations, too, will be wildlife-focused, and I will be joined on the workshop at PRIMER by Dr. Axel Wolf, also on this seminar. So with that, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bob. That was a very informative and interesting talk. Today we'll be accepting questions about oversight of research using wildlife. Dr. Axel Wolf and Ms. Susan Silk will be joining us for this portion of the webinar. Dr. Wolf is Director of the Division of Compliance Oversight at OLAW. Ms. Silk is Director of OLAW Division of Policy and Education. Please write your questions in the box on your computer screen. It's in the lower right. We will answer as many as we can in the time that we have. Additional questions that we receive within 2 weeks after the webinar will be amended to this transcript. The OLAW staff and Dr. Sikes will answer those questions. So send us your questions now or later. We will start with the questions on capturing and housing some of these critters and with questions that we received prior to this webinar. And I'll start off because a question came to mind. Bob, you mentioned water snakes needing live prey. That made me wonder, in your own research, what species has been the most challenging to work with and keep in captivity? What specialized husbandry and housing did you provide?
Well, I guess that really is a pretty easy one, and it involves the two species on the screen now. The pocket gophers, I've already talked a little bit about the husbandry. The real challenge with the pocket gophers was actually capturing the animals. The student wanted to work on behavior of these animals, and all the commercially available traps were kill traps because these animals are considered pest species, and the traps are designed to kill them. That doesn't work well for studying behavior. So we actually had to develop a trap that would allow us to trap these animals, to capture these animals efficiently and unharmed. That took probably a year or year and a half. The other species that was a real challenge was the collared lizards, and these are shown on the right side of the screen, lower right, and their experimental enclosures above. This particular enclosure, 8 feet long, and there were 16 of them in this room, is filled with industrial sand. Basically, it's a chipped granite. To set this system up, we had to haul a little over 2 tons of this industrial sand into the enclosures. We essentially covered the floor of this laboratory 4 inches deep with industrial sand, hauled in 5 gallon bucket at a time.
Well, thank you very much, Bob. The first question from outside is for Dr. Wolf. Is it okay for the IACUC to approve a protocol for research with wildlife when some of the permits are approved but others are pending?
Well, potentially, yes. The protocol could subsequently be amended if an additional permit was approved. However, as Dr. Sikes explained, the protocol should not be approved with contingencies if a key permit is missing that has to be in place before work is allowed to start.
Thank you. The next question, question two. This one's for Dr. Sikes. Do some wildlife permitting agencies require proof of IACUC approval before they will issue a permit?
George, I've heard of this. It may happen occasionally. I don't think it's a general rule. In fact, I can't point to any agency that I've ever dealt with that required IACUC approval prior to approval of a permit. But again, I have heard that investigators have run into this. I just don't have any specific examples. I don't think it's common.
Thank you. Question three, this is for Dr. Wolf. Is wildlife research often an issue for OLAW?
Generally, no. However, NIH has funded some studies, such as ones on bird flu, which involve trapping and bleeding a variety of wild birds. In such studies, the IACUC must ascertain proficiency of the investigators and staff to humanely handle these animals, address euthanasia, and address occupational health and safety issues of personnel in the field.
Thank you. Question four. This one's for Axel also. How many assurances with OLAW specify that all vertebrate animal research will be conducted according to the standards of PHS policy, regardless of funding source? What types of research fall under this exclusion?
Well, OLAW's record-keeping system doesn't exactly capture this information the way you ask it. However, OLAW does advise institutions that the maintenance of uniform and consistent standards is an essential ingredient in the development and implementation of a quality animal care and use program. Only when an institution can document that the animal care and use program funded by a non-PHS source is entirely separate and distinct, physically and programmatically, from PHS-supported activities, will OLAW consider its exclusion from the assurance. Unless there is such total separation, OLAW cannot accept the potential risks presented to animals involved in PHS-funded research. Institutions should also keep in mind the public perception that institutions not wishing to conduct portions of their animal research program in accordance with the policy may be applying a double standard of animal care to the detriment of overall animal health and well-being.
Thank you. Question five is two questions. I'll read them both, and Dr. Sikes, then you can comment on them. The first one, since you do not know how many organisms of the species of interest you will catch, how do you determine animal numbers to request in the animal use protocol? And the second part is, how do you account for species of fish caught that are not of interest and not listed in the animal use protocol?
Well, estimating numbers of wildlife estimating numbers for wildlife projects certainly is very, very different from projects where you order animals from vendors. Field researchers usually worry more about getting an adequate sample size for statistical testing than they worry about having too many, but the opposite can happen occasionally. You might capture more than you want, more than you anticipated, sometimes by a lot, maybe even an order of magnitude, especially if you're setting drift fences for amphibians at certain times of year, or perhaps seining fish. So that'll kind of pull in that second question. It's important for the PI and the IACUC to realize that this capture success can vary substantially with season and with population density and with local conditions. In writing protocols, I would estimate on the high side as far as the number that might possibly be captured, but then set the take number by statistical justification or using some other criterion. You might state in your protocol, for example, that it is possible to capture as many as 500 or perhaps 5,000 salamanders or fish per site using drift fences or seines, but that you're only going to retain, let's say, 30 per site as a collected sample, or maybe 30 per sex per site. The related issue is a potential capture of non-target animals. As I've noted in the talk, many capture techniques are not species-specific. The protocol we developed addresses the potential capture of non-target species in Section 1. As a matter of fact, it requests that you list potential non-target species that could be impacted. There's also a statement in that section that species list can be general, such as all native fishes, because really you don't know what might be in your seine when you pull through this stream. If PIs and IACUCs consider these questions in the protocol and in the review, well, it should be adequately addressed. I always encourage very general species lists because you often do not know what or how many of each species you will encounter. It depends on the weather, the population levels, and it depends on luck. Another thing to consider is that capture locations of non-target species are also really valuable data. These species, these specimens themselves may be valuable if they're preserved as vouchers and if the collecting permits and protocols allow. In other words, when you're collecting these animals, if your permits and your protocols allow, these incidental animals may go into a systematics collection and a record base that the permitting agency is going to find very useful as well. And there, they're available, at least a sample of them, is available for researchers sometime in the future. As just an aside and an example, my master's thesis dealt with geographic variations in bobcats, and I collected data on bobcat skulls out of museums only. Some of the skulls were collected, some of the specimens were put up by Teddy Roosevelt. I don't think he put them up with the mind for me doing this in, sometime in the future. Setting sample sizes and species lists for a project is where experience with the local taxa and the local conditions really helps inform PI requests and IACUC decisions.
Thank you. Here's the next question. This one's rather complicated. It's a series of related questions, and I would refer the people to look at the little box at the top because it helps to clarify. So I'll read them all. First, how do you handle species of interest organisms that are caught and are injured, but not as a result of trapping activity? And species of interest organisms that are injured as a result of trapping. And the same question, but this time for non-target species. That is, how do you handle non-target species that are caught and are injured as a result of trapping activity? And the follow-up would be, and non-target species that are injured as a result of trapping.
Okay, this one's for me, right?
Yes.
Okay,
sorry.
George. Okay, well, this question actually opens many doors, and it's tempting to peek into each one of them. But the sample matter, the simple matter is that you can, what you can do and what you should do really is going to depend on the local conditions, the local situation, and the decision is going to have to be made on the spot given these local situations. The non-target species, again, that's addressed in the protocol. That's section one. The PI and the IACUC really should be considering what the potential impact is on non-target species, which ones are likely to get in the traps or in the seines. The injury issue is also dealt with in that protocol. I think it's section five. And the PI is asked to complete a section on how they are going to treat injuries should they occur. And this would include non-target animals. So let's think about this in field situations. If it's a non-target animal that came into your trap injured, are there injured animals walking about in the wild? Absolutely there are. And you will see them occasionally. One could be detained by your trap. Should you do anything with that animal? In most cases, well, probably not. They may wind up being prey for a predator that evening or sometime later. The point is, you didn't cause that injury, and the predators are going to be eating as well. If you decide to euthanize the animal, whether it is a target animal or not, that's actually going to depend quite a lot on the size of the animal. Let's say you have, there's a big difference between doing something with a euthanizing an injured mouse and an injured deer or an injured elk. If you're doing this with a chemical agent, what are you going to do with that carcass? You can't really leave that thing out there for these chemical agents to get into the food chain. Packing a mouse out is pretty easy. Packing an elk out is a different matter. Sometimes those non-target species, if you wind up euthanizing it, they may wind up in a systematics collection as well. It's a good record. For the target animals, these are ones that you caused the injury to by setting the trap. If it was an incidental injury, then, yeah, you do need to own that. And in most cases, euthanasia is probably going to be indicated. If you can use the animal, if the animal can be used for the purposes of the study, then it may make a valid sample, particularly if the animal will be killed as a portion of the study.
Thank you. The next question is for Dr. Wolf. If a scientist provides a scientific justification for using a method of euthanasia that is not permitted by the AVMA guidelines, and the IACUC approves that scientific justification, does this have to be reported to the IO as a deviation from the guide?
No. In this situation, the exception is already built in that the guidelines state that deviations are acceptable if justified for scientific reasons and approved by the IACUC. This would not be a departure from the guide and does not need to be included in the semi-annual report to the IO.
Thank you. I've thought of one quick last question before we go on to the ones that have recently come in. We're an institution that does not have a large number of wildlife studies, and we're also very much involved in post-approval monitoring, which is one of the emphasis areas. How does that apply to field studies where it could be very difficult?
Well, we don't expect IACUCs to go out in the field. The investigator should provide as much information ahead of time or during the study for the IACUC to understand what's going on, and this can be supplemented by pictures or videos from the field, but it's not required the IACUC actually perform inspections or physical visits to the study site.
I would agree completely, and you know, in addition to or in place of pictures perhaps, just a simple conversation with the IACUCs and the PIs, I think would be completely appropriate. Find out what they're doing.
Okay, thank you. We've had a couple of questions come in, which we don't have slides for, and I'll read these. The first one, apart from a standard IACUC approval and the state animal permits, are there any special considerations for wild-caught animals that are used for community outreach programs, the public on local animal species rather than laboratory research?
You know, we actually keep these animals for these purposes or have in the past as well, and we keep them under a teaching protocol.
Okay. The next question, 52% of our campus is restored and preserved wetlands and uplands. Interactions with animals occur for both research and educational activities. When we conduct these activities off-site, required permits are obtained to track the potential harms to the individual animals and overuse. Interactions with the animals on our campus are increasing as the researchers and student population grow. Are you aware of other universities conducting wildlife research in a similar situation? If so, would you like to contact them to discuss how they manage both the land and animal resources? I would like to contact them, sorry.
Well, I don't know of any offhand that are doing this, but I'll tell you the resource that I would turn to for this type of question. This would be an excellent question to post on a number of different listservs. One of them would be the IACUC listserv. You could just send this anonymously and have people reply, or you could send it with your name attached. Either way, I think it's a completely fair question, and these are listservs that put people in contact that have this sort of information.
Thank you. The next one. Are you aware of the concept of blanket protocols? That is a protocol that encompasses many species, research methods, and multiple investigators. Can you identify any concerns with this type of protocol? I think Dr. Wolf would be appropriate for this.
Well, yeah, we are aware of those types of protocols, and in general, we don't find them to be a good idea. It's important to be very project-specific and precise. If a protocol is too broad, it's often very difficult for the PI and the IACUC to actually track what's going on, and this can lead to noncompliance. Teaching protocols could potentially have varied species and research methods, and some specimen collection work may involve different species and collection methods, but even with those types of protocols, it's very important that they're very clear and that the ability remains to track the specific procedures and the species involved.
Thank you. Susan, are there any other questions that have come in?
Yes, there are. In fact, they're flying in. So many are coming in that we're going to extend for 15 minutes beyond our normal time. So if any of you have to leave, we understand. Just go ahead and log out, and these questions will be included in the webinar transcript. The first one I'm going to read, I think, is a good one for you, Bob. Can you provide information on transportation for wild-caught animals, including health and safety concerns?
Okay, transporting wild-caught animals. Obviously, you want to know what species, what are the potential hazards associated with those species, and the individuals need to have the proper screening for working with animals to begin with. In some instances, it may be suitable to use microisolator tops or something like that. In other cases, depending on the species and the potential hazards, they may need to be outside a passenger vehicle, outside the passenger compartment of a vehicle, perhaps in an enclosed trailer. Regardless, however you're hauling the animals, you need to make sure that it's climate controlled and appropriate for the animal.
Okay, thank you. The next one, we'll call this question B, is for Axel. Has OLAW taken a policy position on the application or adoption of the Canadian Council on Animal Care's 2003 guidelines on the care and use of wildlife by assured institutions for review and approval of protocols involving wildlife and field studies? And the person who wrote this provided the link. You'll be able to see that link on our website, on our transcript.
Well, OLAW hasn't taken a specific policy position on this per se, but we would treat it the way Dr. Sikes mentioned any of these taxon-specific guidelines, that they can be a supplement to what we already require. So if there are things in there that are very specific to a species that someone is studying and it goes into greater detail than the guide, it may be appropriate to refer to this.
Here's another one for you, Axel. Question C. In your example of feeding live fish to water snakes, Bob's example, what does an IACUC do about the distress and welfare of the fish?
Well, if indeed live prey needs to be fed, that needs to be ascertained first, but it's clear that many animals will only eat live prey. The IACUC does need to address the care of these animals, the prey species, up until the time they are used. There will be a brief period of distress when they're being chased or captured, but that's part of it. That is the idea is to minimize the amount of stress. So up until the time during rearing or housing, they need to be kept separate and appropriately cared for. And then the charge to the IACUC is to make sure that pain and distress is limited to the amount necessary for that study. And we acknowledge there will be some pain and distress by the prey, but in this situation, it's a necessary part of the study.
Axel, can I chime in on that one?
Absolutely.
The way that I'm familiar with this particular protocol went, the fish were actually obtained as food from a bait shop. So they were acquired the morning that they were fed. They came into the animal lab and then went into fish cage or snake cages.
Well, I think that certainly minimizes the amount of time that they would have been subjected to any distress. Sounds like a reasonable approach.
Bob, when animals have to be captured, what are the guidelines that your IACUC uses for assigning a USDA pain distress category?
Oh, actually, great question. And I'm going to refer to the taxon-specific guidelines. In fact, the Ornithological Council and the Mammal Society collaborated on a position statement with regard to this exact question and went through some of the examples of how these pain and distress categories would translate into the capture and use of wild animals. So those are actually contained in the latest edition of the Mammal Guidelines.
And they can find the link to that in the slides that are going to be posted and in the transcript that's going to be posted from this webinar on the
OLAW
website.
Absolutely.
This again is for you, Bob. Would you differentiate humane killing from euthanasia? Many use both terms interchangeably.
Well, the latest version of the AVMA guidelines makes a distinction there. And it's not defined one way or the other than to say that in many instances these wild animals, because they can't be brought to hand, that applying the terms euthanasia to the techniques used may not be a very good fit. So this is an option that the AVMA has provided. Quite frankly, I think that in field settings, using that language would be very appropriate.
Well, here's another one for you. Do you recommend a health and safety review as part of the IACUC review for field studies?
Well, I can tell you what we do. So this is a one-off example, I guess. We have a questionnaire that everyone that is working in field settings completes, and this includes students in classes. So before these students can participate in this work, then they have to do the screening. We get an email back from Health Services that says students X, Y, and Z are cleared to go, so that there's no HIPAA violation there. We are not in possession of their medical information. We just have a list of cleared students. If there are cases that the Health Services Center is concerned about, then they can talk with a student. This is repeated for at least annually if these students are still enrolled in classes. So yes, they are reviewed, and this includes the personnel working on those projects.
And so that sounds like a best practice, doesn't it, Axel? Do you agree?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Bob, do the guidelines address engaging the local wildlife rehabilitator community for assistance with housing, diet, enrichment, and release?
They do not, but these are certainly resources that any PI or investigator could avail themselves of. Usually we try to put the people in contact, the interested party in contact with whomever we know that has expertise with that taxon.
Here's one for you, Axel. In the case of animals that need live prey, do we need a separate IACUC review and approval for the prey animals?
These prey animals are live vertebrate animals that would not otherwise be used other than for the study, so there needs to be some kind of IACUC oversight somewhere. Whether this is in the form of an actual protocol, it could also be handled in the form of a standard operating procedure, that here are the prey animals, this is how we get them, this is how they're kept, this is how they're fed, so that they're appropriately handled up until the time they are actually used as food. So there's got to be IACUC oversight, but whether it's on the protocol or an SOP, that's really up to the institution.
Axel, are the use of avian embryos or eggs covered by the Animal Welfare Act?
Birds are not currently regulated by the Animal Welfare Act.
Bob, most of this session referred to research on wildlife within the United States. What have you experienced in handling international wildlife research and permitting that can take up to a year to obtain?
Well, I have done some of that. I have not done international work recently. If I were posed questions regarding that, I would reach out to my colleagues because I don't have the current information. I know that many of those permits take very long periods to get through. So I can't answer that directly.
Okay. Back to you, Axel. If a faculty member has a permit to collect roadkill for comparative skeletal elements, does this require IACUC review?
Well, in this case, the animals are dead, and they were not killed specifically for the study, so they are not considered to be live vertebrate animals, so there would not be an IACUC review requirement. However, the institution, for liability reasons and for protecting the investigators, may wish to address safety concerns that could be encountered in this type of a study.
And here's another one for you, Axel. Under what circumstances, if any, could thoracic compression as a method of euthanasia for wild rodents be considered acceptable?
Again, something like this would need to be addressed under scientific justification and IACUC approval. If there really is a scientific need to do this and it's IACUC approved, that would be, as we mentioned before, one of the acceptable deviations. And of course, in an emergency, if an animal is in distress, then there's no other way to relieve the suffering, that would be considered humane slaughter or humane emergency killing at that point in time. That would be acceptable under that circumstance.
Bob, do you know of guidelines for feral cats and or dogs?
Guidelines, no. There is a position statement on the ASM website under one of the links. It's under the Animal Care and Use tab of the Mammal Society, and it's a position state from the American Society of Mammalogists regarding feral cats.
So they can look there, huh?
Yes.
Bob and George, maybe both of you could comment on this. What is your greatest challenge in post-approval monitoring of field studies? Can you recommend any strategies that have worked well for you?
Well, we don't have many, and we've sort of gone along with what was mentioned earlier. We talked to the investigator. We have looked at photographs. We don't require these, but sometimes investigators are glad to show off the photograph of their field studies. So that's pretty much all we do.
Bob?
In my situation, talking with the investigator usually is the go-to. Ours is a relatively small institution. I serve on the graduate committees for many of the students that are doing this. And, you know, let's face it, we enjoy getting out and doing this stuff, so I go out in the field with them. Many of the some of the other IACUC members go out in the field with them. If we can, we're going to.
How, either of you that like to answer, how do you handle a numbers justification for wildlife studies?
How do you handle numbers justification?
Go ahead. A little bit on what they're doing. If it's a clear-cut study where they know the composition and maybe the degree of change, if they're actually doing something to the animal, then you can use pretty much typical statistics such as power statistics. But if they're just doing observation with or without trapping, then it's a little more difficult. If they're trapping to collect samples, then usually they can also use a statistical approach. If they're trapping to collect numbers for some observation, you know, then we have to essentially go along with what the PI feels is a reasonable number of animals to just trap and release.
I have two comments here, and I'm going to read both of these, and then if you would like to comment on them, you can. This participant says, not a question. We have an investigator who wishes to use kangaroo rats and will trap them on National Park Service land. They told her she had to have an approved protocol before they would consider her application. Another participant wrote in with a comment on agencies requiring IACUC approval before issuing a permit. We had a situation where an agency, they don't remember which specific agency, required IACUC approval before issuing the permit. In that case, we submitted a letter indicating that the protocol was ready for approval after receiving the permit. We did not give an approval date. The agency issuing the permit accepted this letter and granted the permit. So that was kind of in line with what you said in your talk, Bob.
Right.
So let's go on. We can maybe get another question or two in here. If the design of a live trap is necessary, should an IACUC request regular updates on the design progress and the number of animal unintentionally killed? And this is for you, Axel.
Yeah, I would say yes. I mean, here you're unintentionally killing animals or maybe subjecting others to pain and distress, and the IACUC should always be striving to limit and reduce this. So there might be, after starting the study, ways to improve on how this is being done. So there should always be feedback to the IACUC on what's going on in the field, especially if things aren't going exactly as originally planned.
And I'm afraid – oh, excuse me, George.
No, I was just going to comment a little further. I think what – we would do, and I agree with what Axel said, we would probably also put a time frame. If it was a brand new design, we'd like to see some information at X time, 2 months or whatever.
Axel, this is for you, and this will be our last question. I am curious about what most IACUCs do when it comes to owl call surveys or field provisioning of animals to facilitate observations, but the animals are not captured or restrained or otherwise manipulated.
Okay, if it's clearly just listening to calls in the field and there's no other manipulation of the animals, such as putting out a tape recorder or something like that with other calls on it, that would not necessarily need IACUC oversight if there's no impact on the population. If you're provisioning animals in the field, putting out bait or something like that, if that's what this is referring to, then you are manipulating the normal behavior of the animals. You could be causing some problems to the population, as Dr. Sikes had mentioned, and that would need to have IACUC oversight, because then there is an impact on the animals and the population. So this question has two different answers. One would probably not need IACUC oversight, and the other one would.
We have come to the end of our time together. Bob, this has been informative and very interesting. I particularly enjoyed your photographs. Thank you for all the work you and your colleagues have done. I know that our IACUCs appreciate the resources you have made available that will help them in their mission to provide humane animal use in a context of good science. I'm getting a bulletin here from Pat who says, we got lots more questions and we will answer them. Yes, indeed we will. More work for you, Bob and Axel. Thanks also to Axel Wolf, George Babcock, Laurie Hampton, Patricia Brown, and the rest of the OLAW staff for their contributions to this webinar. And lastly, thanks to all of you for participating in our webinar. Today we have 350 registered participating groups that include participants in all 50 of the United States, Puerto Rico, Canada, Argentina, St. Kitts, Nevis, Mexico, Panama, Peru, Spain, France, the United Kingdom, India, Iran, Pakistan, Japan, Singapore, Thailand, China, and South Africa. Bob, imagine how many species you could capture if you went to all those that you could study if you went to all those countries. It has been a pleasure for us to spend this hour with all of you in all of these time zones. We hope that you will take advantage of the recorded versions of this and previous webinars that are posted on the OLAW website, and that you will join us for the next webinar in our series, Alternative Searches. That webinar will be presented on June 26, 2014. Goodbye for now.